Hello and welcome to the 105th session in the AISafety.com reading group. Tonight we'll be discussing two articles, AI and Compute by Dario Amodei and Danny Hernandez, and Interpreting AI Compute Trends by Ryan Carey. Dario Amodei is the team lead of AI safety at OpenAI and the author of the influential Concrete Problems in AI Safety article. Danny Hernandez is the founder of Evident, and it's not obvious how he is connected to OpenAI. Ryan Carey is a research affiliate at the Future of Humanity Institute and has for a long time been at the Machine Intelligence Research Institute. The two blog posts is first a quantitative post by OpenAI trying to figure out how is the amount of compute available to AI projects trending. And the second by Ryan Carey is an interpretive blog post trying to figure out if this trend will continue and where it will lead us. AI has been improving dramatically, and the first OpenAI article considers three main reasons: algorithmic innovations, data, and compute. Algorithmic innovations have clearly happened and there are improvements to the algorithms, but it's really hard to quantify in any meaningful sense how much they are improving. There's also a lot more data available now compared to 10 years ago, but this is a very heterogeneous domain and it's not impossible, but still very hard to quantify. The amount of compute is much easier to quantify, so that is precisely what OpenAI has done. In particular, they look at the compute for training a single model. And this means that AIs that employ several models are not considered here due to what they call the limits of parallelism. And in particular, ensemble methods, which are reasonably used in practice, are not considered for this. One of the problems with just adding compute to AI projects is that we often see strong diminishing returns. There have, however, been a number of more recent techniques that seem to scale much better. In particular, deep learning scales well with increased amounts of compute. In this way, we can see that the amount of computing power and the algorithmic advances are to some extent complementary. Some other examples of ways that algorithms take advantage of more compute are huge batch sizes, architecture search, and expert iterations, which are mentioned in the article, but which I will not go through here. The key point of the article is this diagram, which I'll show in just a minute, about flops. A flop is an abbreviation for a floating point operation, meaning to add or multiply some numbers that are not integers, but like 1.345678, a decimal digit. Floating point operations per second are called flops, and a petaflop is 10 to the 15th flops, which is 10 to the 15 is peta, this SI prefix. The unit that is used in this article are the petaflops day, which is the amount of floating point operations that can be had by running a processor that runs at one petaflop per second for a full day. And since there are 86,400 seconds in a day, this comes out to roughly another 5 orders of magnitude. So meaning that a petaflops day is 10 to the 20th floating point operations, roughly. Now the barrier here in the left, we have the y-axis, which are the petaflops days per second, the petaflops per second day in training, and a single one is at this level, and this is like 1/1000th of a petaflop a day. And of course on the x-axis we have time. And we see around the beginning of 2012, we got a few results of AI models that had this amount of performance. And as time progressed, we got some stronger results. And finally, in 2017, we got 10th, even hundreds of petaflops days. And finally, AlphaGo 0 and Alpha 0 had more than 1,000 petaflops days. This line here is from the article and is the best fit of these data points. So this line corresponds, of course, to a doubling time since this is a logarithmic axis. So and the this is 3.43 months doubling times or 104 days, which is a very, very impressive growth rate by just about any means. The authors identify a number of eras through this to try to explain what has happened. The first era is what happened before this graph, before 2012. Back then, AIs were generally running on CPU central processing units, and if we to get a sense of the scale, I've tried to see a 1 gigahertz processor, 10 to the 14th petaflop days, it would be around here on the graph. So if we are further to the left than this place, we would be around here, very, very low and below this graph. Starting from 2012, we start to see GPUs being used in general for things like AlexNet and DQN. From 2014 and the next 2 years, we see large farms of graphical processing units, which enable much higher performance. Starting in 2016, we see specialized processors called tensor processing units and better algorithms really starting to make a big change in this. This trend up to the end of 2017 obviously might continue. There are many reasons to believe that the trend will continue. In particular, many startups claim that they have new hardware that will enable even better performance than this. I will point out that there is in particular one company which is not a startup, which is Google. And at the very end of this graph, we saw AlphaZero using what is now called first generation tensor processing units, and they are currently using third generation tensor processing units. So it seems very plausible that the hardware is continuing to improve. We will most likely also, according to the OpenAI post, see a lot of maturation in the hardware and ways that existing hardware can be reconfigured for more performance. We will also see a maturation in the algorithmic work. In particular, many of the advances are not combined yet. We'll see things like massively parallel SGD, where SGD is not explained in the article, but that's stochastic gradient descent, one of the key algorithms in neural networks. Another reason why we would expect the trend to continue is that most projects right now spend much, much more on deployment than training. So if training is only a tiny bit of the budget for an AI project, it's plausible that this budget could increase dramatically. Further, the hardware requirements to build something that is state-of-the-art is on the order of $1 million. And the world in total uses $1 million, $1 trillion for hardware in total. So this, the amount of hardware spent on a single AI project is absolutely trivial. But it is of course impossible to predict the future, and OpenAI has this important caveat. Ryan Carey from MIRI and the Future of Humanity Institute looks at how long this can in fact go on. And they have he proposes an economic model looking at the rate of growth of the cost of experiments, the current experiments, and the maximum amount that a project can command, how many dollars it can cost in total. From this, of course, we can infer how long this trend can go on. So on the right here, we have Moore's Law, one of the classic reasons why we expect that hardware costs will come down or be more capable. So how quickly does hardware in fact go get cheaper? Well, Moore's law says 70% per year, or in the formulation that almost everyone uses, is a doubling for every 18 months, and this comes out to a factor 10 every 4 years. And AI impacts have made recently another quantitative analysis, which we haven't read here, concluding that Moore's law has slowed down substantially right now, and every year we are seeing growth on the order of 20% per year, which comes up to 10 to 16 years for a factor 10 improvement. And if we want to, Ryan Carey for some reason prefers to have the time, as his, the unit he uses is the time for a factor 10 increase. So if you want to change the calculation from the 3.5 months doubling time into how long time for a factor 10 increase, he does it using this particular calculation. And from this we can see that the costs for the experiments seem to be increasing by around a factor 10 every 1.1 to 1.4 years, meaning just slightly longer than the factor than the improvement time for the software, meaning that the experiments AlphaZero, AlphaGo0 are massively more expensive than the original, the experiments that we saw in 2012. AlphaZero currently costs around $10 million, or the hardware costs is that. This is actually a reasonably difficult thing to calculate, but the estimates seem reasonably sound. And the greatest experiment we could probably have would be something performed by the United States government, because they seem to be the actor which can command the most resources right now, or within the next 5 to 10 years. How big an AI project could the United States government make? Well, Ryan Carey assumes 1% of the GDP based on comparison with things like the Manhattan Project. I think this is an interesting problem, and it depends a lot on, in my opinion, on how much progress we are making towards artificial general intelligence. If we are still seeing the kind of narrow projects we are seeing now, we are unlikely to see something cost 1% of the GDP of the United States. But if an AGI is developed, we might see a political perspective where it is creating a decisive strategic advantage, and in this case the resources might be much, much larger, even comparable to the Second World War, where the United States spent far more. But even in this case, it would probably be really hard to hire enough AI developers or hardware manufacturers. It is probably easier to scale the economy for a total war than for an AI project. In this case, if the limit is 1% of the United States GDP, we would see the trend must stop within 5 to 6 years. For smaller actors, in particular companies like Amazon and Google, we would see the trend maxing out, where they would be unable to compete for economic reasons within 3.5 to 4.5 years. Greg Buckman from OpenAI has claimed that he believes the current trend will continue for the next 5 years, even without any strong assumptions. And Ryan Carey seems to disagree with this and believes that the trend is likely to stop before that. How can we get further? Well, we might have more specialized hardware. Now we're seeing tensor processing units usable for deep learning, and we might conceivably in the future see hardware that is made for one precise algorithmic implementation. Ryan Carey suggests that could give another factor 1,000 in the performance, which would a factor of 1,000 would correspond to another 3 to 4 years of this trend continuing. I think this is important. Here, it's important to not double count the evidence, because the trend is already including hardware improvements, such as going from CPU to GPU and tensor processing units, and this is beyond that. The way this could go much, much further would be that the general economy got into a feedback loop with the improvements in AI. And in this case, the limits with the economy would not matter because the economy would just be growing. This is what many people would call the singularity. If an AI project caused the economy of the world to double every 3.5 months, if it's not technically the singularity, but this, if this happened, there would be very, very, very many changes and next to totally unpredictable if this happened. So the conclusion is that this trend will stop in between 3.5 and 10 years. And this could be interpreted as saying that if the trend continues for another 10 years, we will have a singularity. And I think that's probably not warranted by this. So I will not, so don't quote me on that the current trend points toward a singularity within a decade. And of course, there are a number of reasons why this could stop much, much earlier. Even if it does not stop, in 3.5 years, we will have much, much more powerful hardware and much, much more powerful AI projects and AI models that have been trained with 10 to the 27th floating point operations, which is an absolutely massive number. This is called a Bronto. The 10 to the 27 is called a Bronto, so like a Bronto flop. And that's a neat word that I've never heard before. And if it continues for 10 more years, we will have AI projects that have 10 to the 33rd operations, which I'm unsure actually what this is called. 10 to the 30th has the name GEOP, so it would be a GEOP flop. And I don't think anyone have even bothered to give a name to the number that is 10 and then 33 zeros afterwards. At 1 and 33 zeros afterwards. So we're this far into the future. And that will happen within a decade, if the trend continues. So the obvious question from this is, how will this affect artificial general intelligence? How much compute is required to have artificial general intelligence? This is a difficult debate, and I will try to sum up three main views on this. The article doesn't give any of the examples of mainstream views on this. The first would be Eliezer Yudkowsky's view, who I believe would say something that the amount of compute required for AGI is extremely uncertain, but he could plausibly see it being far, far less than 10 to the 27th floating point operations. Ray Kurzweil would probably argue that this demand depends to us. This is very tightly coupled to the number of floating point operations or operations that the human brain uses. So probably the amount of compute required for artificial general intelligence is the same amount of compute required for the human brain. The third major major perspective on this would be the Hansonian view by Robin Hanson, that what we will actually see AGI being made is as a simulation and emulation, an M, and we only need what is required for simulation of an M. Well, we can compare this with a human. Both Robin Hanson and Ray Kurzweil compared this with a human. So let's see, look at a human. A human gets its intelligence through a process called a childhood. So how much compute does it require to simulate a human for the duration of a human childhood? Well, we would need something that has as much compute as a human and then run it a lot faster. And it would need also algorithms that goes as good as the human brain and architectural knowledge, data, and of course a lot of compute, because a human childhood basically takes 18 years. And running a program for 18 years means running it for 5 times 10 to the 8th seconds. That's how long it is. And this means that we will see how it depends on how much computing time it takes to simulate 1 second for a human and then multiply that by 10 to the 8th. So One of the simple estimates for how difficult it is to simulate a human brain is by Moravec, who estimates 10 to the 13th floating point operations to simulate the human brain for 1 second. This requires a simple model of the neurons, but he is simulating every neuron spike that happens. In total, for this to simulate a human childhood would take 10 to the 22nd floating point operations. There was a questionnaire by AI Impacts also trying to get this information from a number of researchers, and the median of these researchers believed that simulating the brain would take 10 to the 18th flop, and this means that running them for an entire childhood would take a bronto flop. Finally, some people believe that it's required to simulate what is called the metabolom, basically simulating every single small molecule in the brain. This requires much more compute, 10 to the 25th to simulate that for just a second, and which comes out to 10 to the 34th if you want to simulate that for an entire childhood. I think this is a very pessimistic estimate. It is quite likely that we will be able to, if it's possible to simulate the human brain in any good way, we do not need to simulate every single small molecule. I think the abstraction of neurons, which I think almost everyone believes that the neurons are really important for the brains. So I don't think the most pessimistic estimates are likely to be true, but I don't have a lot of knowledge about this. Another milestone is what is called, what Ryan Carey calls the AlphaZero Games milestone. Because AlphaZero used 2.5 million Go games to become a stronger player than any human. And for a human to play 2.5 million games would require 300 years. So this means that we could imagine that training something with something that's like a human brain for 18 years, we would have general intelligence, like the human childhood. And if we train for 300 years, we would get something that is a super intelligence. Of course, this milestone, going from 18 years to 300 years, is something that at the current trends, where in the doubling is 3.5 minutes, that will only add 14 months, which is a very short time. There are reasons why this milestone might be enough, and there are reasons why it might not be enough. A reason why reaching this milestone is insufficient is that general intelligence and Go are two very different things. You would think that you'd need a lot of more training examples to get general intelligence compared to only get intelligence for Go. And if you have more tasks, then you need to learn a much more intricate mapping from actions to utilities. On the other hand, however, we might see an AGI before getting this much compute, because AlphaZero used no pre-existing knowledge, and we could definitely program some existing knowledge into an AGI, and it is quite possible that the human brain is not in any way optimal or anywhere near optimal. It's quite possible that only a fraction of the computer is required to actually simulate it. Another thing I would point out here was that AlphaZero played a small number, 2.5 million games, and this is a number that has been trending downward strongly compared to what came before. Before we had AlphaZero, we had another algorithm called Stockfish, and Stockfish played much more games. It searched two orders of magnitude more positions compared to AlphaZero. So there's a reason to fear or expect that the next algorithm will require much, much fewer games in order to become superhuman. One of the most far out ways of reaching artificial general intelligence It's, for instance, described in one of the first chapters of Nick Bostrom's book, Superintelligence, is by simulating the evolution of the brain, all the way from a very early worm, the first with a nervous system, and then we just simulate the evolution of the brain through basically 1 billion years. That will require, so in this case we are trying to estimate how many neurons need to be simulated in the entire evolutionary history of the world and in 1 billion years. And this comes out to a very high number, because simulating just a neuron for 1 second cost somewhere between 1 and 10 to the 10th floating point operations. This is an extremely inaccurate estimate. And the amount of compute required to this would go from between 3 to the 41st or 3 to the 51st floating point operations, which will be probably completely out of reach, at least unless this trend continues for a long time. But this is a zero knowledge way of building an AGI, and it's very likely that using either human intelligence or using human as a model for the algorithm would strongly improve on this very, very strong, very, very weak lower bound on how long time it will take. A final way to look at how close we are to artificial general intelligence is to take what is called the outside view. And Ryan Carey optimistically says that this provides some assurance that artificial general intelligence is more than 6 years away. The way to use the outside view is to say, is AGI as close to AlphaGo 0 as AlphaGo 0 is to AlexNet? AlexNet being the first of the algorithms shown in OpenAI's model. So there are three factors. We're looking at compute, AI research, and capabilities to see what is the difference between AGI and AlphaGo 0. This is, of course, a really, really difficult thing because we do not know where AGI is. What we can say is that in compute, we can say that if it continues for another 6 years, then we will have something that is much stronger than the human brain if we just simulate the human brain. If we go further than 6 years into the future, it seems we'll be able to have something that simulates the human brain, but it's weaker than that. But since we have so much computing power, we might get the same results. And having this is what is often called a hardware overhang, and is considered something really dangerous from a safety point of view. And it seems we'll have that in 6 years compared to a simulation of the human brain. How much AI research has happened from AlexNet in 2012? To AlphaGo 0. Well, it seems there's been a lot, and I followed some of the footnotes to Ryan Carey's, and there was some number from CB Insights that claimed it's grown 50% growth in funding for startups per year, and I think that's I'm somewhat skeptical for how much that is, but I think a factor 10 would probably be reasonable. And finally, what is the difference in capabilities from AlexNet to AlphaGo 0, and how far is there from AlphaGo 0 to artificial general intelligence? Well, AlexNet did image recognition between a couple of classes, and AlphaGo 0 is an algorithm capable of solving basically all board games. So it feels like there is a substantial step up in generality. How much generality from solving all board games to solving everything? Well, this might not be what we really care about. We only care about if the artificial general intelligence is able to get a decisive strategic advantage in some way, and full AGI might not be required for that. So I think in total, the amount of assurance we have might not be that much. That is all. Thank you, and see you next time.